Blackstone presents Life Ceremony, Stories by Sayaka Murata, translated by Ginny Topley Takamori. This book is read by Natalie Naudus, Nancy Wu, Jeena Yi, Pun Bandhu, Emily Wu Zeller, and Eunice Wong.
A First-Rate Material. It was a holiday, and I was enjoying chatting with two girlfriends from university days over afternoon tea. Through the window, the gray office buildings of the business district sat beneath a cloudless sky. Reservations at this hotel lobby tea room were hard to come by, and it was thronged with a female clientele. An elegant white-haired lady with a deep purple stole across her shoulders daintily carried a piece of tart to her mouth. At the table next to us, some girls with colorful painted nails were taking photos of their cakes. One of them spilled apricot jam on her white cardigan and hastily started wiping it off with a pink handkerchief. Yumi opened the menu and ordered a second cup of tea, then noticed the sweater I was wearing.
"Hey, Nana, that sweater, is it human hair?"
"Oh, can you tell?" I beamed at her, nodding.
"Yes, 100%.
"Fantastic! It must have been expensive."
"Yeah, a bit.
I took out a loan, but it'll last me for life," I answered rather bashfully, lightly running my fingertips over the garment. The jet black hair was closely knitted into rows of braids, with an intricate weave at the cuffs and neck, and it glistened alluringly in the rays of light shining in through the lobby windows. Even though it was mine, it was so beautiful, and I gazed at it, enraptured. Aya was eyeing it enviously, too.
100% human hair is just the thing for winter. Warm, durable, and luxurious. My sweater contains some, too, but it's so expensive I could only afford it mixed with wool. But human hair really does feel completely different, doesn't it?
Thanks. It's too special to wear every day, and normally I keep it safely stored away, but today I really wanted to dress up. It's the first time we've seen each other for ages, and coming to a hotel, too.
"Really? But now that you've bought it, it's such a waste not to wear it more," Yumi said.
Aya agreed.
"Expensive clothes are not meant to simply decorate your closet, you know. You have to put them to good use. Nana, you're engaged to be married now, aren't you? Human hair is just the thing to wear for formal occasions, like meeting your future in-laws."
I toyed with my teacup.
"Well, yes, but,"
I said in a small voice,
"you see, my fiancé doesn't really like clothes made from human hair."
"What?"
Aya's eyes widened in bewilderment.
"Why on earth not? I can't understand that."
"I can't either, but it's not just human hair. He doesn't like any fashion accessories or furnishings made from human materials," I said, forcing a smile.
"You're kidding."
Shocked, Yumi put the macaroon she'd been about to put in her mouth back on her plate and looked at me dubiously.
"So, what about bone rings? Tooth earrings?"
"He can't stand them. We're talking about making our wedding rings platinum, too."
Aya and Yumi looked at each other.
"Really?
But wedding rings made from front teeth are the best."
"Nana, your fiancé's a banker, isn't he? He must be well off, so isn't he just being stingy?"
"No, I don't think it's that,"
I answered vaguely and smiled. I couldn't explain it very well myself.
Aya nodded triumphantly. "Yes, there are people like that who are loaded but just don't understand fashion. But Naoki's always so well-dressed. I never have expected it of him. When it comes to your wedding rings, though, I'd discuss that with him a bit more. After all, they're what you'll be using to pledge your eternal love for each other."
She raised her teacup to her mouth. On her left hand was a ring made from pure white bone, her wedding ring, made from a fibula for her marriage last year, and it looked really good on her slender finger. I still clearly remembered how envious I'd felt when she'd happily shown it off to me, even while explaining that it was considerably cheaper than tooth. I surreptitiously stroked my ring finger. The truth was that I did want a ring made from either tooth or bone. I'd talked about this any number of times with Naoki, and I knew better than anyone how futile it was.
Look, go once more to the shop together. If he can just see what it looks like on his finger, he'll change his mind, you know.
I gave a little nod, looked down to avoid their eyes, and reached for the now cold scone on my plate. I just said goodbye to Aya and Yumi when I felt my cell phone vibrate. I took it from my bag and saw that an email had arrived from Naoki, who'd had to go into work even though it was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.